Good morning, ladies.
Good morning.
Did one of you make the call?
Well, that was me. I'm Mrs. Collin. We tried knocking, ringing her number, everything.
She couldn't have just overslept.
Not her.
Well, she was going to do my hair today. The granddaughter's getting married.
Do you know the name of the occupant?
Betty Powell.
Right. Betty? This is PC McCann, Sandhill. Can you open the door, please?
You're going to break in.
What do you reckon, Gary?
Yeah, I think I better add.
Okay. Sierra Oscar from 643 receiving, over.
Go ahead, Jane.
We're at One Beveridge House. We can't get any reply. We're going to break the door down.
You won't find it easy. She's got chains, bolts, you name it. Yeah.
Right, can you just keep back, please, everybody? Right back, thank you.
Here we go. Well, that was easy. June, we need an ambulance. She's still alive.
If anyone wants to know where I am, Susie, cover for me, will you?
And what should I say?
Could you sound it convincing, all right?
A darn suspicious death on the Abelard. June Ackland went with the ambulance to St. Hugh's. The victim died soon after she arrived. Gary's waiting at the scene now, so the sooner you get down there, the better.
Yes, sir. All right then, Susie. Come on.
Tea.
Oh, thank you very much. Cheers.
Did she die then?
Yeah, afraid so.
There's two wounds. One to the face and a crushed skull.
So it doesn't rule out a straightforward accident then?
No, I suppose not.
Sarge.
What have you found out, Gary?
Not a lot. She wasn't the most popular girl on the block.
How old?
Mid-40s or so, she said.
She lived alone?
Yeah.
With plenty of precautions.
Well, not that she used any of them.
Maybe she knew him.
Or her, Susie.
This is where I found her. You can see where she might have hit her head on the side of the table as she fell.
Anything missing?
Nah, TV and video's still here.
Yeah, it's expensive gear.
Yeah, and she still had her jewellery on. Rings, a brooch, pricey looking.
What about take-ins from the hairdressing?
No sign of any cash.
Any idea when it happened?
Yeah, between 10:30 last night when she asked the neighbours to turn the music down and 7:15 this morning.
Great.
Yeah, but when I found her, the blood was dry, so I reckon she'd been there all night.
Neighbours worth talking to?
Yeah. Trina, couple of doors down, number 8.
What do you know about her hairdressing business?
Not a lot. She had a few old bags in for a curl and a rinse. Pocket money.
So whoever hit her wasn't after her cash?
If she had any, she wasn't stupid enough to keep it at home.
Did you know her well?
No one did. We didn't mix. Well, she didn't.
Oh?
She wasn't too keen on living here.
Any particular reason for her wanting to get out?
Nobody had it in for it, if that's what you mean. She wasn't that bad. Just thought she was a cut above the rest of us, and she wasn't.
Family?
Don't think so. She had blokes, though.
Boyfriends?
Yeah. Minicab driver. Ray Bennett. Used to knock on my door sometimes when he was drunk. And I never let him in case you were wondering.
This where he works?
Yeah.
She dumped him. The guy who runs a shop. Hayes's on the Oxton Road.
Hey, excuse me, sir.
I'm sorry, we're closed, but tomorrow's normal. 8:30 on the...
Are you Mr. Hayter?
Yes, but...
I'm Detective Sergeant Beach. This is WDC Cross, Sunhill Police.
It's a bit awkward.
We'd like a word with you about Betty Powell. Name Isabel, eh?
Well, yeah, but look, do you mind if we wait till later?
What is it, Jim? I'm Mrs. Hayter.
I think it might be better if we left it till later.
Left what?
It's the police, Marion.
What's going on?
We're investigating an incident on the Abelard estate.
It's about Betty Powell.
Yeah, I'm afraid that she was the victim of an attack and your husband knew her.
Jim's father was the one who knew her. Look, I'm sorry, we'll have to go. We can't be late for the crematorium.
Yes, of course, I'm sorry to bother you at a time like this.
Can I ask what happened?
Let's go, Jim.
Could have been a bit tricky, couldn't it?
We noticed.
Hayter must have been getting on a bit.
Well, I suppose it makes sense. Something a cabbie for a businessman.
Oh, size of man's wallet that counts, is it, Susie?
Yeah.
Mr. Bennett.
Who is it?
A DS Beach, Sunhill Police.
He's not here.
Come on, Bennett.
Maybe Bennett was her bit of rough, Susie. Women like a bit of that, don't they?
You'd know better than me, Sarge.
DS Beach, WDC Croft, Sunhill, please. Can we come in and have a chat, Mr. Bennett? Thanks.
It's about Betty Powell.
Who?
One Beveridge House, Abelard Estate.
I don't know her.
Does the name Hater mean anything
no.
to you?
No. Look, what's this about?
What about Trina?
No.
She lives a few doors down from Betty. Trina's the woman you keep leaving these with.
Betty Powell was found unconscious in her flat this morning.
She what?
We think that she was attacked, probably by somebody she knew. Do you know anything about that?
No. She going to be all right?
When did you last see her?
I haven't seen her for weeks. She... I stopped seeing her.
Why?
She gave you the elbow for Hater.
So what?
You're angry about that?
Yeah. No. Oh, I was. The old boy popped his clogs and...
Oh. You knew he was dead then? How?
Betty rang me up and told me. I went round 3 days ago. She just wanted company, that's all. I haven't seen her since.
So you still see each other on and off, then?
She don't give a toss for him. He's just an old codger with some wedge. A ticket out of Abelard.
How's that?
It was all set to get married, she said.
So she must have been disappointed when he died.
Well, not disappointed. Still reckon she's going to get something.
What? A legacy?
I suppose.
So it was all... lovey-dovey between you two, was it?
We was friendly, that's all.
And you didn't go round there last night?
I told you, no.
Where were you?
Here. I got back about 8. I ain't been out since.
Can anyone confirm that?
No.
You see, Betty Powell died from her injuries shortly after being taken to St. Hugh's.
Ex-boyfriend. Loser. No alibi.
I'm telling you, Bennett fits the bill perfectly.
I'm not so sure, Sarge.
Come on, Susie. He was making it up as he went along.
Well, he might have been telling the truth about one thing.
Oh, what's that?
Betty was in with a chance of getting a legacy from Old Man Hater.
Hmm. So you think we should have another talk with Jim and Marion, do you? Crash the wake?
No.
Oh, you disappoint me, Susie. So what do you suggest we do then?
Well, we could talk to your solicitor.
We could win the lottery.
It's worth a try.
We'd need to know his name first.
Well, maybe the Undertaker knows it.
All right, you do that. And see if Socko's come up with anything. I'm going to have a cup of tea.
Busy day?
Leave it out, Rod. I've had apple pie croft buzzing around all morning.
So you've got a suspect, then?
Miss Clever Club's got a couple of those, but not a whiff of anything that you could use as evidence. Well?
I spoke to Socko, Sarge. Nothing yet.
What about the solicitor? Anything there?
Nothing.
Surprise, surprise.
He suggested we go and speak to him in person.
A solicitor did? How'd you manage that?
Tact, Sarge.
Do you mind if I, Thanks.
So Betty Powell came to see you?
The day after Mr. Hater died.
Did you know who she was?
I'd heard.
That they were going to get married?
It was apparently a possibility.
So what did she want?
She asked what was in the will.
You told her?
No. I wasn't obliged to at that point.
But you knew what was in the will?
The answer you want, I imagine, is no. Betty Powell is not a beneficiary.
Right. Thanks.
Well, that's simple enough, isn't it? So, why have you asked us here, Mr. Davis?
Yesterday morning, Mr. Hater's bank told me there'd been some withdrawals, substantial ones, from his account.
Made after he died?
Just before, while he was in a coma. According to Jim Hater, Mrs. Powell did have access to his checkbooks. It's something over £5,000 altogether, so I'm looking to recover what I can on behalf of the estate. Any help would be appreciated.
Right.
The forged checks with the bank. You'll need them. I have no examples of Mrs. Powell's handwriting, obviously.
Well, that's no problem. We can do that. Okay, Susie. Thank you, Mr. Davis.
Mr. Davis,
When Betty Powell came to see you, did she challenge Mr. Haight as well?
She believed she had rights as the deceased's fiancée, yes.
Did she?
No.
But she could have made things very difficult.
She was remarkably well informed in other aspects.
Such as?
Well, legally, she could have been very obstructive.
She could have contested the will by claiming that there was a subsequent one in her favour.
Yes. There are a number of ways to delay probate for a considerable length of time.
But what about costs? Could she have afforded that?
It's common for the estate to bear the costs of both parties.
What kind of period are we talking about?
Anything up to 6 or 7 years.
Mr. Davis, how long have you known the Haighters?
30 years or so. A very solid family.
How did Jim feel about his father taking up with this fancy woman?
If you're asking me whether Jim Haighter was capable of violence towards her, the answer's no. I'm convinced of it, whatever his feelings. I would not have invited you here otherwise.
But nevertheless, while Betty Powell was alive, she presented a serious threat to Jim's inheritance, right?
Yes.
With any luck, we might get a ham sandwich out of this.
D.S. Beach, W.D.C. Croft. We spoke briefly this morning.
Yes?
I'm sorry to bother you again today, Mrs. Haighter, but wondered if we might have a word with you.
Of course. We were about to have some tea. Would you like some?
Yeah, right. Thanks.
The police officers from this morning, Jim.
Oh, yes. How is Mrs. Powell?
Oh, I'm afraid she died soon after being taken to hospital.
Oh, dear. I'm sorry. Could you bring the tea, please, Jim? Do go through.
Right, thanks.
I'm afraid we can't pretend we're very upset. We didn't really get to know Mrs. Powell.
Were they getting married, your father-in-law?
No. No, there was no date set. There was no announcement in the paper. He would have published the banns in church. He didn't.
Engagement ring?
She bought it herself.
Oh, there was one then.
She used to flash it about. Please sit down.
What contact did you have with Mrs. Powell?
Well, she was sometimes at the flat.
Jim's father lived over the shop.
She wasn't the sort of person you... Look, I know he went off the rails towards the end, but before...
He was a fine man. The shop's a testament to his life, if you like. He built it up on old-fashioned principles, from nothing. He counted service before profits. We'll be carrying that on, won't we?
Yeah.
Still, you can't have been too pleased about Betty contesting the will.
There was no basis to her claim.
She could have held up probate. Legal costs could have been quite considerable.
She really didn't have a leg to stand on.
What exactly is it you want with us? I mean, it is the day of his funeral.
I expect they want to know where we were last night. Am I right?
Well, if you wouldn't mind. Susie? Yeah?
We were here, weren't we?
Preparing for today.
You didn't go out at all?
No.
Mr. Haighter, your father's car.
What about it?
Well, do you know where it is?
It's in the garage down by the shop, I should think. Why?
Well, one of our officers has just found it abandoned in Claydon Street with a smashed window.
What the hell's it doing there? That's the second time it's been stolen.
So you wouldn't know how it got there, then?
No!
There's the car, Sarge. Neighbour says it's been here about an hour. I thought it was a bit suspicious because whoever broke into it did it while it was still parked here. There's the glass. Point two. Steering lock's been taken off.
Neatly. If you'd have stolen it, you'd have smashed it.
So whoever did it drove it here and faked the signs?
Looks like it.
Sarge.
Bennett.
You can't explain how it came to be in Claydon Street.
No.
Well, it's with our forensic experts now.
You can't get good prints of a car.
Oh, you know about things like that, would you?
No. No, I never even knew he had one.
Well, how did that get in Haighter's car, then? You work for Canley Cabs?
It's a big company. They get handed everywhere.
Let me try and guess what happened. You and Betty worked this little scheme out together, right?
What scheme?
Take the old man for as much as you can get. Forged some checks.
What checks?
Help yourself to his car. Sell it. You'd be the one to find a customer, right?
No.
Then you fell out of a division of the spoils, so you thumped her. That's what happened, isn't it?
I was in Basildon last night on a job. I just borrowed the car. It was Betty's idea. Mine was knackered.
Betty had Hayter's car?
She had his spare key. She used to use it. She offered when I went round. I had to have a car.
So why didn't you tell us all that this morning?
I panicked. I didn't want to get the sack, did I? If it was reported stolen.
So after we came round, you dumped the car and faked the theft?
Yeah. No, I never thumped her. I had no reason. I was in Basildon. Ask him at work.
Oh, brighten my day, Susie, will you? Tell me you've got two eyewitness accounts of Jim bashing the granny out of Betty.
No. But I got these from questioned documents.
Oh, yeah?
I think you might be interested, Sarge.
Well, go on then.
Well, he compared six of the forged checks against six of Betty supplied by her bank. And he says that on comparing the questioned checks with the ones known to have been written by the suspect, I can find no evidence that the suspect wrote the questioned checks.
So what does that mean? That Betty probably did it, but the CPS would have chucked it out on the evidence?
No, 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 Sarge. I gave him a call. Now, apparently it's unlikely that Betty had done it. The forged checks have many of the hallmarks of left-handed writing. Betty was right-handed.
You sure?
It's all couched in maybes. He said it's not evidence, but an indication. But I reckon we're looking for someone left-handed.
We've just come to let you know about your father-in-law's car, Mrs. Hayter. Apart from the broken window and putting the steering lock back on, it's okay.
Have you found the thief?
No. Apparently Mrs. Powell lent it to one of her friends.
No, Baba.
Here, you better have these. Get your garage to pick the car up from Sunhill. Would you mind signing a receipt for these, please, Mr. Hayter? Susie?
Yeah. Just there, please.
By the way, who had access to your father's checkbook?
No one apart from me. And the Powell woman, of course.
Would you mind witnessing it, please, Mrs. Hayter?
What about you, Mrs. Hayter?
Well, yes, obviously.
You're left-handed.
Yes.
The person who forged your father-in-law's checks was probably left-handed.
What are you trying to say? Well, no, it was that jumped-up tart.
Mrs. Powell? No, she was right-handed.
Of course it was her. No one else could have done it. For the benefit of the tape, we are showing Mrs. Hayter sample check forms provided by the Question Documents Department. Do you recognise these?
Yes.
And is that your handwriting?
Yes, it is. What happens to them now?
Well, handwriting expert will compare them to the forged checks in their possession. They can match like with like very accurately. And their findings are regarded as evidence in the courts.
But he's dead. You can't do anything to me now, can you?
Are you admitting to forging checks on your father-in-law's account, Mrs. Hayter?
But I haven't done anything wrong. I was only taking what was going to be ours anyway.
Did your husband know you were doing this? We can ask him.
He wouldn't have understood. Things have to be black and white with him. I just wanted to save what I could from that awful woman.
So he didn't know?
It's ridiculous. He won't press charges. It's our money. Surely you're not going to arrest me for taking what was already ours.
Well, if your husband doesn't make a complaint, it's not likely.
Well, then.
But the CPS still have the charge of forgery to consider.
Well, you know where to find me.
Just a minute. If Betty was going to argue the will, you might have been found out. Isn't that right? Maybe Betty knew what you were up to. Did she threaten to tell Jim? And did you go round there to try and talk her out of it?
No.
Mrs. Hayter, I'm arresting you on suspicion of the murder of Betty Powell.
I don't believe you.
She's admitted it. Handwriting analysis will confirm it. She's also given us full details of the account that she paid the cash into. This has all come as a surprise to you, hasn't it, Mr. Hayter?
Did she say why?
Can I ask you again about your wife's movements last night? Did she go out between the hours?
Why didn't she tell me?
Mr. Hayter, we're still investigating Betty Powell's death.
I've got to speak to my wife.
Oh, yeah? Why is that, Jim?
Because if she'd tell me the truth, Betty Powell wouldn't be dead.
Can I please speak to my wife?
No.
Why not?
Because we've arrested her on suspicion of murder.
What? No. She was at home, don't you see?
You went to Betty's?
Yes, I went there.
What time?
I don't know, about 11:30. I was angry. I just didn't want her at the funeral. I went around to ask her not to come.
But she refused.
I couldn't stop her, she said. Told me she was going to sit at the front in a big hat so as everyone could see her. She laughed. She told me things about her and Dad. It's disgusting.
What happened then?
I lost my temper.
And?
I hit her. She fell against something. She wouldn't get up. I kept telling her to get up. I didn't know what to do, so I went home.
To Marion. Did you tell her what happened?
I was going to report it, but Marion told me not to. She was so calm. Took my clothes. Told me to have a shower. She said the woman was being punished for her greed, for all the things she'd done.
She meant about the forgeries too. Where are your clothes now?
I don't know. Ask Marion.
I've confirmed that your husband was wearing these things last night.
He shouldn't be in here. You've got it wrong.
All right, Mrs. Hayter. I think it's time you went home now.
It was an accident. He's a good man. He had every reason to... He was provoked. He didn't mean to hurt her.
Why do you think your husband didn't call an ambulance? Even when he got home. Didn't he realise he'd left Mrs. Powell to die? Yeah. Puzzled me too. Show her out, Susie.
Could I see Jim, please, before I go?
Yeah, all right.
I have to ask Mr. Hayter first.
All right.
Do you want a quick word with your wife, Mr. Hayter?
No.
Time to go home, Mrs. Hayter. WDC Croft to show you the way out.